welcome to vlog number 2 of day number 2 of Star Wars Celebration. Today was another great day. Once again, the energy was all around the XL London Arena. It was incredible. Even to be in line sometimes is not that bad because you feel the energy from the rest of the crowd. And today I got some great cosplayers to show you. And of course, we're going to start with the booths and the art galleries and what I saw there. And I'm going to let you enjoy them with some music. So please do enjoy. And the music. Let me know if you enjoyed the music as well. Let me know what you would have gotten from those booths. And right now I'm going to show you what I did get today. And of course, I told you about this in the previous vlog yesterday, and here it is, the Han Solo Huff Funko Pop figure. It wouldn't get lower than 15 pounds in any booth, so I decided to take it home finally and rest assured that I have the Huff Han Solo figure. Next, I got the stickers that were a bonus because I got this. And this has 8 cards. There are only 1,000 made for each of these, and of course there's a certificate on the back. I'm not sure if you can. There you go. And of course, Star Wars Celebration. And those cards are Kylo Ren, Captain Phasma, a Stormtrooper, Finn, Rey, Poe Dameron, Han Solo, and Master Luke Skywalker. But the best thing that I got today was one thing that I was looking forward to get from a long time ago, ever since The Force Awakens came out, and that is The Art of Force Awakens. Finally, I got it because I finally found it in English, and in my country, it's only sold in Portuguese. Not only that, I'm glad I waited so long and that I didn't order it online, because today the author, Phil Sostak, was there and he signed this book for me. Check it out. Great autograph. And he actually knew Portugal and he told me to say hi to Portugal. So my friends from Portugal watching this video, hello from Phil Sostak. And I got this little promo for art by Ralph McQuarrie, and there's a 2-volume, the definitive deluxe 2-volume slipcase of Ralph McQuarrie's complete artwork for Star Wars. It's coming out in September. So that's what I got today to bring home and to show you guys, but I also saw some great cosplayers, and today I probably saw the greatest Star Wars cosplay I've ever seen, and that was this guy cosplaying as Darth Maul, and he had the spider legs from the Clone Wars, and this is not the last time we'll speak about the Clone Wars in its video, and I want to let you enjoy all the cosplayers that I saw. Guys, there were people from Knights of the Old Republic, which was awesome. There were lots of droids, lots of Imperial Guards, lots of different Stormtroopers, lots of different Bounty Hunters. There was all this mishmash of any cosplay from Star Wars that you can think of. It was really awesome to see. You want to see the Star Wars Rebels Season 3 panel, but before that, of course, you already saw the trailer. I'm not going to do a trailer review just because I don't want to make this video any longer than it has to be, but I'll give you right now a quick review, no spoilers, do not worry, of the first 2 episodes that come combined, of course, as a mini movie for Star Wars Rebels Season 3. So the episode starts with soundbites taking us back to the finale, with Ezra screaming for Ahsoka and Ahsoka screaming for Vader and Anakin, and then we start anew. They are in the middle of a mission. Zeb, Sabine, Ezra, it was awesome. It was great to see the new look for our characters. It was great to see some old characters. Of course, this episode to me is not better than Siege of Lothal, which was a season 2 premiere, but it is better than season 1 premiere. What I like most about this episode is that it shows us something new, but it brings us back to our familiar characters. These characters are still the people we know. But of course, there are very interesting things happening with Ezra. You saw a couple of shots that might hint you to that in the very famous trailer that is now circling the internet. We do get to see Thrawn in the first episode. That is all I'm going to say. I really enjoyed this episode. I really enjoyed what Kanan had to do in this episode and evolve. I like Ezra very much in this episode. You can clearly see even the actor that gives the voice to Ezra has grown very much since we last saw or heard him. I don't usually give grades to episodes, but I will do it just for you because they showed me the trailer just for me and everyone on the celebration stage. So, to this premiere, due to the character moments, the story was very interesting. There's a very different tone than what we're used to, so prepare yourselves for that. It was a great episode, and I'm going to give it an amazeballs rating. My geekies, before I give you the Star Wars Rebels Season 3 panel, I want to thank you all, because we have finally hit 200 subscribers. Yes, we have finally done it. I was walking out of the panel, and I see in my live count website that we have hit 200 subscribers. We are now officially on the road to 300 subscribers. So of course, if you are not subscribed and you are watching this video and you enjoy movie reviews and talking about Star Wars and these Star Wars vlogs, subscribe to the channel by clicking in the button below the video box and join our beautiful geeky community where we can be geeky, united, share this video with your friends, family and enemies, and let them all come in and bask on the geekiness and the love that we have for Star Wars, for it is the greatest saga ever told. And of course, my friends, you all know that there are links to my Facebook and my Instagram in the description below, and you guys can stalk me on the internet by going there and find out all the news about Star Wars Celebration that I'll be keeping you updated through my Facebook and through my Instagram, of course.
He defeated the Empire. Destroy the evil Queen Balth Mordor. He danced with David Bowie. He taught Harry Potter to be a wizard.
Splendid.
And then he shut him in a vault as he depressed a galaxy as Marvin. Elvis as the leprechaun.
Thank you very much.
He wore a big beard as Nickelbrick. He danced a jig for Johnny Depp. He traveled abroad with an idiot.
What are you doing?
And he stood in a bin with a face for Ricky Gervais.
It's
getting shorter as it goes over here.
Fantastic, and Ewok Wayne, the first ever one. Woo! So, are you having a good time at Celebration? Amazing time here, and it's you guys that make it so special. It's fantastic, and I've been asking you to tweet your memories under the hashtag SWCEPics, and we've got a few to show you now. Let's see the first one. There's a couple there, and that was just a few minutes ago. They're right in this room right now. Where are you? Oh, they decided to leave. Over there. It's more than two hands gone up. That's strange. Okay, what else have we got here? There we go. Oh, that's me earlier on. On stage with Anthony Daniels, who hijacked the beginning of my show. That's that one. And what else have we got here? Ah, it's rather odd. Matt, and he actually tweeted that of himself. Okay, fantastic. So, yeah, let's keep those pictures, those memories of Celebration coming. That'd be great to see them. Right, so we're all here to talk about Rebels. All in a bit of a spin. We saw the demise of a few baddies, brought back Darth Maul, blinded Jedi Kanan Jarrus, and it left us all wondering what happened in the epic battle between Ahsoka Tano and Darth Vader. So hopefully, season three will shed some light on all of this. But in the meantime, maybe I can persuade the creatives behind Rebels to tell us some more. So please give a forceful welcome to Supervising Director Dave Filoni. Woo! Great to have you here.
Yeah, it's great to hear. It's always a fear before any panel. I'm sure they agree. Empty, but thank you guys for coming. I know there's so much to do. So thank you for coming to spend some time with us today. We really appreciate it. Thank you.
We all love it. I mean, you know, Rebels, obviously, judging by this, is a hugely popular series. So congratulations on that. How does it feel? I mean, it's just so fantastic, the work that you all do. But to come here and actually see the kind of the people that enjoy it and meet them face to face, it's one thing working in office on the series, but then coming here, it's great, isn't it?
It feels pretty great because we get to interact with you on, you know, on social media and things, but to get to actually meet you in person is so gratifying and exciting and fun. So hello, thank you for being here. Woo!
Question on all of our lips is, did Ahsoka survive the battle with Vader?
Right out of the gate.
Alright, so we'll get this one out of the way. You know, I always think I have it, and then look, Yoda says a lot of things to Anakin. You know, death is a natural part of life. Miss people, do not mourn them, do not. The conflict with Vader and Ahsoka is something that we had prepared for almost a decade, and it was something I had discussed with George Lucas over different periods of time. And then finally, what's amazing to me is we actually got to do it. And that's something that, when I'm sure you know, creating series and characters, that you're never actually sure when you have long-term plans for a story arc what you'll actually get to tell. And when Clone Wars ended, I was worried that, like, well, I guess any hope of establishing that and making that happen was going to go away. So we had a great opportunity when Rebels came about to actually tell that story. And we took our time, and I think we really did it right. And judging from the fan reaction, I think they'd agree. And the only thing I've said is that most likely, when it's a character I really like, and obviously I like Ahsoka, it's going to be hard to kill her off. If it was someone like Vader, that would make sense, but I'm not going to say in what way, but it's likely that you might not have seen the last of Ahsoka Tano. Woo!
So, do you want to say something to him?
I'm just surprised that he went that far. I think he's going to, like, dangle something and not tell you.
We will say nothing more.
We've had some lovely exclusives.
What way that would be, it could be a cheap out like a flash pack, you know what I mean? Or I could
the clip show
a picture of a lunchbox, you know, and it'd be like, yeah, I mean, you know, they would hate that, so it probably won't be that way, but...
So now looking ahead to season three, I understand that a couple of characters got some new looks.
Yeah, they did.
For oh!
Sure. You can see Kanan there and still blind from his encounter with Sam. And, you know, we've decided to kind of move forward with that. There's a lot of great samurai stories that Doichi about the blind swordsman and, you know, it was something that we had discussed earlier on in the series, what will happen to them as we go along the way. And Freddie, who plays Kanan, is a huge fan of samurai films. So he actually understood exactly what we were trying to do with this kind of wounding of Kanan and what it means for his character, giving him something to look at his life in a different way, literally, like change the way he's doing everything. And you'll see the implications for his character, the way this changes the way he looks at life. Is going to be, I hope, compelling and make him a better Jedi in the long run.
What about, we've got new looks for Ezra as well.
Ezra as well got a haircut. It's one of those things, you know, he also has a bit more of an attitude. Teenager, you know, so that parents can relate to that. We have to be true to real life. Star Wars isn't working right if it's not reflecting real life. So you'll see a lot of metaphors as Ezra kind of advances as a teenager that he as well has changed. Season one, a lot of people didn't like his kind of Aladdin hair, so then I get rid of it, and then everyone's like, why don't you cut his hair? And I just can't win that way.
That'll teach you to respond to the fans.
Yeah, when the stuff comes out, they're like, one day I can have a little girl who's a bad one, and now they're like, please don't say she's dead. And it's like, okay, I guess.
So who's directing the show, them or you?
Definitely me, because they'd probably tell you I don't listen to them anyway. I try hard, though, but you shouldn't try, so... That's my failing, people.
They do or do not.
There you are. Oh, they can't see that slide yet. Right, because the next one's on the right.
You were briefed.
We worked on that backstage.
Now, Tia, let me turn to you. You play Sabine, okay? Now, can you tell us about the character, how she grew through season two, and what's in store in season three, perhaps?
Well, for one, I just want to say that I think Sabine looks totally awesome.
Oh,
and
yes.
I'm really excited about this new hairdo. Hopefully, whoever, if any of you have your Sabine, you know, outfit. Now you have a new hair to go find and make or whatever.
Are you ever consulted in these looks at all?
So actually, after season one, Dave asked me, he said, we're going to change Sabine's look for season two. What would you like her hair to look like? And I was so flattered and... like taken aback that he would have asked me my opinion, and I told him, and he did not take that to heart. Like it was totally different than what I asked for. But this is exactly what I asked for. Like so,
it took production. It takes a while. So you told me.
He was like, "Oh, that's a good idea. We're gonna do something else."
In the future.
But, yeah. Well, I didn't know that was ever gonna happen, and now, and here she is. That's exactly what I wanted. So thank you. I don't know if you did that for me, but. Maybe I planted a seed way back when.
So through season two, we learn a few more things about her, but we still don't know everything, do we? There's more secrets.
And we won't know everything in season three, but we get to know a lot more, which I've been so excited about to get to record, because we get to I get to interact with more Mandalorians.
Ooh.
I may or may not be related to some of them.
Woo!
Okay. It's really, I'm usually not right next to Dave when I get asked these questions. It's a lot more it's warm up here. So we get to know Sabine a lot better and get to know a lot more about her past, and she sort of has to face her past in a real way, a very tangible way, and sort of sees people from her past. Maybe related, maybe not, but there are some altercations. I don't know how much I can say. I'm just going to keep saying until you cut it out.
Fascinating. I'm learning so much.
And she has some new gadgets.
Oh.
Yeah, that's good. That's so good.
Wow.
was there, Sam.
That was good.
Yeah. Give her a little emperor. Tell her she's doing good. Yeah.
Well, I'm excited to say that we have a Series 3 clip.
A clip?
Yeah.
Yeah, we are very much filming here. We don't have many shadows here because we want you to watch the show when it's on TV. So here's a little clip from Season 3 of Sabine in Action, I believe.
Okay, let's see it.
Yeah, Hera and Zeb had small modifications to them. Hera, because she's a lot more part of the growing Rebel Alliance, she has more of a military look. Uniform. She wears a rank badge now, and it's just to show that she's really becoming a part of that formalized rebellion. And then Zeb, we actually stripped him down a little bit. Some of the armor came off of Zeb, and I think it actually fits him more with a New Hope look for aliens. So we're trying to start to fuse the looks of our show, and actually now that we know a lot more internally, Lucasfilm, about Rogue One and the look of that film, we're doing some things to bring the kind of colorful world of Rebels in line with what you see in the film there. So there's a lot of kind of nice synergy going on thanks to the efforts of Story Group and the production team on Rogue One, which I think is what we've always promised at Lucasfilm, that type of continuity.
That's really interesting. That's really great. Now, Sam, to turn to you. You voiced Maul for the Clone Wars, and you do now for Rebels. In the film, the live-action films, we don't really find out too much about him as a character. Now, is he really half the man he used to be?
He's something like, I mean, I think even, he's like a third of the man he used to be now in Rebels. We keep cutting down fractions on this poor guy. Oh, look at that. That's interesting. That's cool. We got Ray Park up there. The guy who I have, I owe everything to.
You've met Ray, of course, yeah?
I did. In fact, I met Ray. Phantom Menace was coming out, and this guy, Ray Park, was in Skokie, Illinois, at a theater, promoting it. And I saw an advanced screening, so I knew who he was. No one else did. So people were just walking by Ray Park, and I'm like, it's Darth Maul! And they're like, who's Darth Maul? He was really, really kind, and I stalked him for several years.
That's so believable.
It's true. It's true. No. Actually, and funny enough, I kept running into Ray before this all took place. I ran into fast food places, all these different places. I'm not even kidding you.
Ran into him.
Yeah. In his house, in his bedroom, at night. It's weird.
Wow.
So weird. What are you doing here, Ray? He's like, Sam, go home. It's late. And it's only gotten worse for him since I started voicing the character, really. It was just it's been really cool. I mean, it's the same process with Clone Wars. Like, Dave will come to me with an idea that just actors need to really make it into something that is worthy of his
thoughts.
For you guys. We do it for you.
And
we do it for Dave.
That's the opposite of how it goes.
Yeah. I'm not sure about that.
So why do you enjoy playing this character, Sam?
Oh, God. Well, the coolest thing is David Filoni. David, can I call
David
you David?
Filoni now.
David, take the hat off, David. Let's go.
Woo! You need to start a merchandising line. Can we buy these hats?
Nope. Go buy a loaf cat, though. Those are in the store.
There's someone running around with Dave Filoni cosplay.
Yeah, is that person here?
Is he here?
Wow, that's cool.
Not that cool. Only my wife thinks it's cool, and that means it's not cool.
Why is he better looking than you are?
Probably.
It's pretty awesome. It's great.
Small Sam.
Right, that guy? The fun of this guy is every time he shows up, since Clone Wars, every episode we've had an opportunity to do something a little different with him. At first he's this crazy guy in a cave with spider legs. And then he becomes a little bit more the Phantom Menace Darth Maul. Then he starts becoming this kind of general tyrant character. And now, I don't know what he is now. He's something else now. What would you say he is?
Maul is now coming to grips with kind of what his life is about, what it's been, what he thinks it means, and he's searching for a purpose. He's searching for some type of existence because he's kind of failed again and again, and he was so close to having the power of the galaxy at his fingertips, being second in command to everything, and he's fallen several times from that grace. So now he's a bit in between. He's still on the evil side of things. He'll never truly be good unless he can find the selfless resolution, which is highly doubtful. So that's kind of where we're at with him as we go on this journey with him in season three. To see where it goes.
And what's sad about that is that, you know, he trained his whole life from a child to become this Sith apprentice, and then in Phantom Menace he's reaching some power, and then he gets knocked down. Clone Wars, he builds up that power, and then he gets knocked down again. And so now he's on his way up yet again, and we're going to see what happens with
this. He just hasn't learned his lesson, has he?
Basically.
So what's his relationship with Ezra? Because that's what we're going to sort of start to see develop.
You mean my apprentice?
Yeah, that's what he thinks. Yeah,
he thinks of Ezra as his apprentice, as a kid who has a lot of potential, but is just a little bit misguided. And if he could just nudge Ezra a little bit toward a different path, that Ezra could achieve everything that Maul has been trying to achieve, and that perhaps Maul could help him along that path, and maybe they together could be. A team. I mean, Maul, I think to a certain extent, is it fair to say that he's looking for a brother of some sort? He's kind of...
Yeah, again, I think it's like, in Ezra, he sees the opportunity to have an apprentice, his legacy, to pass on something that he knows as the Emperor taught him the dark side, and he wants to imbue that in this young boy and make a reflection of himself. But it's done from a selfish motivation. He doesn't see that, but it is. So you're always with the Jedi and the Sith and the dark side and the light dealing with opposites. And the Sith and the dark side is always self-interested, selfish, and the Jedi and the light are always selfless. That's why when Obi-Wan says, if you strike me down, I'll become more powerful than you can possibly imagine. It's because Vader can't imagine a power that comes out of being selfless. And that's the root of that idea. And we're extending that in things we're doing in Rebels.
That's fantastic. That's great. Well, we've got another exclusive clip now of Maul in action from season three. Do you want to set this up for us, Dave?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's about it. Okay. Well, something we're doing with Maul is, again, expanding his character, showing you that he has, a lot of times, maybe not just a wielding lightsaber guy, but there's dimensions to his character. So let's see what we find out here.
Absolutely. Let's see it.
People and characters before us. I got to believe it. Continue quickly.
You're not going anywhere. Well, I'll continue with.
I'll give you a trivia quick, though, before we start. I said continue, now I'm taking it back. But I've done it. But the set that you saw there, that they were acting out on, the characters, is actually something from Clone Wars. That was a set that we were going to use in season 6 or 7 to continue Darth Maul's story. So that was for an upcoming episode in Clone Wars, and when the production team and I were going over how we could do these episodes in Rebels, I said, well, we had that old set, how far could we get with it? We looked at it, we said we could use it, so we tweaked it and painted it up to look like Star Wars Rebels, and so there you go. It's, again, a legacy continuing and connecting things. So Maul knew about that place and was there because he would have been there in Clone Wars had we continued. So there, some trivia.
Wow. I mean, I love the way you talk. Physical set, you know.
That's how I was taught to think about it by George. Everything that we discussed as I was brought up, you know, in filmmaking by him was live action centric thinking, because that's how he thinks. So he didn't know any other ways that our communication existed on that level. And, you know, it really helps CG production, actually.
Absolutely. Now, we've got another exciting exclusive here, because we are the first people to enjoy the trailer for season 3 now as well.
The trailer, right? We're right into it, huh?
Spoiling us.
We might as well, because I like to show something and then talk about it a bit. Okay. Why not? We got you here, we got you guys here. So let's show this trailer and talk about it, and let's just take a moment and let's just expand the universe a little bit, shall we?
Yes.
Woo! have you done?
Where did we get it? No problem, guys. We got your back at Lucasfilm. We're all good. Look, you couldn't have grown up a Star Wars fan without encountering Thrawn and Heir to the Empire. It was a significant part of most of our lives growing up. There was a dark time where there weren't new movies and we were looking for new material, and all of a sudden there's a trilogy of books called Heir to the Empire. Blew our minds. Like, how could there be more? Started Rebels, and we're in this time period. Head of story group, Kiri Hart, and I, we have a lot of like-minded things that we want to see in Star Wars, and one of them was always... We tried to strategize on when it would be best to bring him in, and if you we go back one slide, if you could, but it was important to do it right, to kind of build the series in the right way. And a big part of that too is finding the right actor to play that part. And I have to say, this was one of the most challenging characters that we ever had to cast in Grand Admiral Thrawn. And we're really lucky we got Lars Mikkelsen to come in and play him. Two Mikkelsons now in the Star Wars universe, which is great, because we've got, you know, Mads over in Rogue One, so that's kind of fantastic, and they can, I'm sure, have a great Christmas talking about the Star Wars galaxy. It's going to be tough to be a Mikkelson and not be in the Star Wars franchise, but it's something we were really glad we could do, and I think, I hope the fans are going to like what we're doing with him. We wanted it to, so there you go.
Couldn't be here at Celebration, but he sent a special message, so let's have a look at that.
Without Tim, you absolutely can't. It's, you know, a character he created, so it was important to us that, you know, he liked what we were doing. And, you know, it's kind of stressful. We brought him in and we hadn't really told him what we were up to, and you know, I made sure to sit down and talk with him about it and the character things and traits that he had, and, you know, luckily he was really excited about what we were doing. So to have his support meant a lot to me as a fan, and I know it would mean a lot to everybody out there. Without that, it's not going to be authentic to me. So, and he's got, you know, a great thing has happened as well. He's going to have a new book come out called Thrawn, and that's the cover of it. And how exciting is that? So you're getting Thrawn in different media all right away, and I can't wait for that. So, good day for a Star Wars fan. It'll be a day long remembered.
Absolutely.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
It's so much stuff.
There's a lot to do. Absolutely. And so, yeah, I noticed you watching the trailer there. You've got the best seat in the house on the floor there. We see Sabine in there. It's exciting, yeah?
The whole thing's exciting. I purposely did not watch any of what we just saw because I wanted to watch it with you guys, because it's so much better this way and not on my laptop. But man, that trailer just blew my mind. Oh my gosh. I think I have goosebumps still. And here I have a jetpack!
She's funny, this is Mandalorian research. She's like, Dave, most of the Mandalorians seem to have jetpacks. When do I get a jetpack? I'm like, don't worry, those resource books lie to you. Don't worry about that, it's not important. No, they're really accurate, but you know.
I have been wanting a jetpack since I knew I was going to be playing Mandalorian, and I finally get one. And it's very exciting.
Woo!
Yeah.
We're all delighted for you.
Thank
you. Your dream has come true. That's lovely. Whoa.
Oh.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, look at that.
What was the
second, wait a second, wait a second.
Wait a minute.
That's not yours.
It's not mine, but...
It's not yours!
I got it, and I'm not going to tell you how. You'll just have to watch it.
Taylor wasn't happy about that.
No, he was not.
No, Ezra was like, what?
Well, first we had to tell him what it was.
Oh, man, why did you do that? She's going to hear about it. Social media, too. Yeah, we like the Darksaber. It belongs with Mandalorians. It was a Mandalorian weapon a long, long, long time ago.
Wait. But possession is 9/10 of the law, man.
I suppose, yeah, but that show ended, and, you know, in between, you know, maybe in the buyout or whatever happened there, Disney Lucasfilm, it went to someone
took
else.
Took it from me, is that what you're saying?
I don't know.
Just say it.
What's that?
Took it from me. You can say it.
That would be like clock giveaway, Sam, and you know I don't do that.
Okay.
So they just got Thrawn. They're not getting that, too. They got the blue guy.
Yeah, when I said gadgets, I meant jetpack and darksaber, so.
And maybe there's some other stuff there, but you don't know about that because you've seen the first animation. Yeah, don't worry. You'll see. It's pretty cool. It'll be just like this moment. Don't worry. You'd be just like this thing you when you were surprised. Wow, and I'm so amazing. It'll be just like that, but later on. It's cool. Trust me. You should trust me.
Now, Dave, I know there's going to be some new characters in Season 3.
There are. Really.
One of them in particular, voiced by a very famous
doctor.
The Doctor. Tom Baker was kind enough to come in and do a voice for us, which I'm super thrilled about. He is absolutely fantastic.
He's got a great voice, hasn't he?
He's got an amazing voice. And it's the second Doctor we've had in the animated Star Wars universe. We had David Tennant on Clone Wars, fantastically, and now we have the fourth Doctor, Tom Baker. And when I wrote this character, he plays a big character named Bendu. You can see him there as a big, big old creature. You could hear him in the latter half of the trailer. Bendu is kind of the middle way of the Force. He's dark, he's not light, he's something else, he's a force of nature. And when I thought of the character and who would voice it, I was like, it's gotta be Tom Baker, because Tom's gonna get this weird, quirky character that he is, and his instincts as an actor feed directly into the performance, and I needed his kind of, you know, he's just so unique in everything he does, and Tom is so full of life. You talk to him today, and he's just bigger than life as a presence, and he's so fantastic. So. Was so glad when we got him, and he's going to make a big difference for the crew of Rebels, of course, and so glad to have him. He's just a different type of Force character creature than we've ever had before, and I think that's what is most compelling about him. So we'll have to wait and see what the rest of it means. I get on a roll, and information starts. And see, they're sneaky because they get really quiet. Like, they want me to forget they're there. And they're like David Morgan and Zelma, they're just talking, and he's going to give away the plot. And I'm like, it worked, and then this thing happens, and that character happens, and I'm like, you know, I can't do that. So, sorry. Because, you know, stuff is going to happen later today with Rebels. Soon, actually, so that'll be...
We haven't got long to wait.
We haven't got long to wait.
Okay, good.
Thank you.
How long have you known Tom Baker?
How long have I known him?
Yeah, just that long.
Just as long as the production of the show. I mean, as a kid, you know, Doctor Who, of course, he's the Doctor in America that we know with the scarf. I mean, that's the whole ballgame. My wife loves Tom Baker. Loves him. We had lunch together while we were here, and she pretty much just left with Tom Baker. That was it. He's a charmer, and Tom charmed everyone in the room, wife included. We're gone. I had some free time then, which is kind of nice for me, and that's all I've heard. We're at a Star Wars convention, all these Star Wars things are happening, great reveals, Rogue One, our show. My wife is like, the lunch with Tom Baker was so incredible. Nothing Star Wars related, but I love it. I mean, it was as much for her as it was for me, because I knew it was significant to her. And that's the thing, I mean, fantasy stories, sci-fi, characters of that nature, they stay with us our whole lives, and who would think that all these years later, be in London talking to Tom Baker and having him work on a Star Wars show, talking to you at a desk. It's insane. You're still in Star Wars. We were talking about that just the other day. You're still, it's,
I'm like a bad penny. Keep popping up in Star Wars. Pretty so you haven't known Tom that long?
No.
Really?
How long have
we known each other?
We go back to Star Wars weekends in Florida, and that's got to be like 2008, so like probably 8 years.
All right, so you've known me longer than Tom.
Yes.
How come he does a voice before?
This is, I knew it was going there! You learn this about actors, people. They're so clever, they're all sneaky. This is Anthony. I see Anthony, Anthony has been known him for years as well. I see him, he puts his arms out. David, Anthony walks me, he goes, "You never put me in your show anymore." And he hugs me, he turns and gone. And he goes, he's out. And that was it. And I was like, all right, there's a subtle hint. We've talked about it over the years. I would love to get you in there. It's going to happen.
Years ago, when we did Star Wars Weekend.
Oh boy.
I spent ages, and I cut a little, I think I took the trailer of Clone Wars, and I redubbed the whole thing with all the different voices. I must have done about 15 voices on this thing.
But you did it so well, I couldn't tell. I didn't know there was you.
That was just me, all of it was me. I did 3PO, I did the droids, I did everyone.
Man, amazing. If you'd have told me that, I probably would have brought you on back then.
Oh, it's too good.
Try not to be that good, you know? Sorry. Well, you know what, though? Do you do mall?
Hi, Sam. What sort of thing would he say? What does he say? Give me a bit of a line for mall. Like something like that.
This is an audition.
Give me a line.
We're trying to figure something out. You feel like, did you go? Why? All right. Do you speak Mandalorian?
I've got to say that.
No, that's not.
I've got to speak some Mandalorian. Or do I say, do you speak Mandalorian? No, I don't speak
Mandalorian. Yeah, say, do you speak Mandalorian? I'm just going to word that.
What, in a mall voice?
In a mall voice. What would a mall voice be for you?
I need the microphone. I need to use the microphone. Give me one of these ones so you can comment on my audition.
Yeah, okay.
So you want me to say, do you speak Mandalorian like Maul does?
Yeah, I want you to see, say very soon, my apprentice, very soon. And when you say it, I want you to say it like kind of, and you know this guy, where he's a great Maul. So if you do it like that, something very dark and evil, but with a slight smile, you know. Make your shirt feel tighter while you do it. All right, so.
Very soon, my apprentice. Very soon.
Uh-oh. You see how I did this? Now the motivation is there. You see how I played you against him?
Here's a role I'd like to audition for.
Go ahead.
It's Wicked showing up on the show.
Yes! Oh my gosh, you didn't know. Yes, could you...
Sorry, you made a spoiler for me.
Make yourself small, Sam.
Okay.
Yeah. Very small. Permanent.
The voice is going to go small. I want you to do dub, and you can do...
Chihuahua.
Yeah, Chihuahua.
That was a little bit too, like a come on though, like.
Yep, yep.
Wow.
Woo!
Oh, that
was
good. What's good to do? You want to switch?
I'll switch.
Alright.
I'll give you that. Cool, man. Okay, fantastic. Now, I believe you're all going to be itching to ask some questions. Mark and Elliot are amongst you with microphones, so can we get a question from our audience now?
Yes. All right, over here.
With Mark first.
Yes.
Hello.
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 Way out there.
Thanks, Matt. You've adapted Strike Force Chantipole from the West End Games. Are you going to adapt any more of the old adventures for the games to episodes?
You know, he was actually just talking to me about that very game play scenario earlier.
West End Games, man.
Right in the green room. Not particularly that I know of.
Wrong answer.
Not particularly that. No, I don't think so. But there are always elements. I think because, you know, I grew up with those games, you see a lot of things winding up in the series. Like the type of aircraft carrier that we brought in was from the games, and I do resource a lot of things from the EU that I knew as a kid, and that Henry Gilroy knew, Steve Melching, you know, those guys are always fitting things in. So a lot of little details, I would say like the name Shandy Pool is gonna come from probably Steve Melching, Gilroy too, because I'll bust them on it, but I think it's cool, so we use it. But you never know.
Very cool. Who's got our next question?
Over here.
LJ Elliott, thank you.
Hi, I'm Francesca from Italy for HeavyHype.com. I'd like to know if the next will be Mara Jade, maybe.
Yeah, I saw that coming a mile away. No, not likely. Not. Look, you
that's
got Thrawn. Answer. Don't say all.
You got a straight
so
answer.
You got Thrawn. Remember we got Thrawn, yay? So exciting. A couple things, you know. Sam asked me to make this clear. So I'm going to make this clear.
You're going to put this on me.
Of course, and no, you'll be glad because you wanted me to say this.
Fair enough.
Which is that, and I might pronounce it wrong because every group I go to says it differently, but the Ysselamari creatures are not something that we brought in to the show. So he won't have the Force Bubble creatures because when I had a talk one point a long time ago in the Clone Wars production with George, and we were discussing those creatures, and we thought they were kind of an implausibility because they were part of a life, they were alive. And things that are alive aren't negated out of the Force, so, you know, at least as we understood it. So I decided not to actually carry that forward. You do see, though, in the clip, he has a statue of two kind of like salamander creatures that I put in his office, and I pulled them right over his shoulder for you guys. So there's like an essence of it, but that's just not something that I wanted to continue because it doesn't seem logical with what we had in the film. So there's little differences like that, but most of the time I try to keep things immensely consistent. So there you go. That's just the level of honesty I'm having with you guys. They're like it or not. You decide. I know you'll tell me on many types of media.
Bob, what do you got?
Hi.
Hi. So much. Person, will she like die and come back as a Force ghost?
Oh, wow, very direct. I've said it before, the young people are always very direct and have the most intense questions. Let's see, if she did, she would have to be aware of, to some degree, the technique, consciousness, thought process that allows that to happen, to be maintain your consciousness after death and be within the Force. Currently, I do not believe she knows how to do that. So probably that would say no, but whether we have to worry about that right now or not is kind of up in the air.
So. This is exhausting, is it not? Like, needing to know and getting these kinds of answers, just like...
Yeah, non-answers, it's great to you.
Imagine being in the recording room when he says this stuff.
Okay, DJ Elliott.
Yep, back in the back.
Hi, Matt from Jedi News. Are you going to get any of the other Clone Wars voice actors back to Daniel Logan?
They want more and more and more.
Yeah,
a little song and they want the Daniel Logan. You know, that's a strange connection. But
I told you, I'm like, you give them Thrawn, they're going to want Daniel Logan. You shouldn't do this.
Yeah, but the correlation was clear to use that.
Oh, Thrawn and Daniel Logan. Yeah.
You never know. It's interesting how part of you never know is no. But, no, I've actually tried pretty hard to bring a lot of the Clone Wars voice actors back, and I've figured out ways creatively to do it a lot of the time. Matt Lanch was able to bring back, you know, which I thought would be really hard since he played Anakin, but found a way to do it. So, you know, I never know. I love those guys. They all did a tremendous work for me. I owe them a lot, and it's fun for them just to come back and be a part of Star Wars. So it's always a possibility.
I don't think you should keep recycling old acts as though you're bringing some new life. You know,
loads more fish in the sea.
You feel so bad right now.
All right, who we got next?
Back in the back. Okay. Bleachers on the left.
My name is Bryce. I'd like to know what is the name of the character who teaches Ezra through the Sith Holocron.
Oh. Are you a small, are you child age to ask that question? I think so.
Yes.
Yes, of course. Back there in the darkness, the voice from the darkness. You're 12. It's always 12 and under, the most dangerous questions. That's a great question. This is a horrible answer. I know who that is, and I'm not going to tell you. It's very clear that I sit, you know, the story people down at Lucasfilm, and I give them this whole history, and they're like, that's great, Dave, and that seems like it'll work. I'm like, okay, cool. So we know. Find out one day.
Cool. DJ Elliot.
Hey, so now that I've got to make a new Kanan costume. I showed him this the other day, and he said, just wait till you see it. The inspiration for the little eye marks, those look reminiscent of Rex's helmet. I was wondering, do we find out anything about that? Do we see how that comes about, why that's chosen, or is that just an aesthetic choice?
The mask he wears in season 3 was one of the most difficult designs, and Killian Plunkett and I went back and forth on it several times. It was so hard to get something that was appealing, that felt like it was from Star Wars. Nothing we were doing felt quite right to any of us. Originally, I had an adapted version of that mask you have on that I had Sabine cut up and modify to be a type of mask for him. So the root of that face shield that he has, I think, is still the ancient Jedi mask that he wore on Malachor, and then Sabine retooled it so it's more comfortable for him to wear regularly. And then finally, one day, I just put the little eye marks on it. It serves two purposes. Outside the world, right, as a filmmaking device, it gives the audience a target for what he might possibly be looking at, which is really important for me, to have some sense of eye direction and a feeling that you're connecting with the character. Inside the story world, for me, I think it's a nod to the fact that he and Rex had a troubled start, but now they're really good friends, and it's like he learned to see things a bit through Rex's eyes.
In the Clone Wars, there was the question between Maul and the Emperor, and I was thinking, will we see more of that action between Maul and him?
You really should do more scenes with Maul and the Emperor, I think. Because the actor is available and willing.
Sam, do you play both Maul the Emperor on Star Wars Rebels?
I do. That's a good point. So now I'm going to say with more certainty, you should definitely do that.
Do you see why he's a Sith? Because it's a very self-serving type of thing. I said Sith are self-serving, not selfless. Wanting a question maybe, but not having one yet to answer, which is so selfless of you, and that's why I admire you on the light side of the Force. What dark side, what?
I'm just saying, I would rather Warwick not audition for the Emperor, because I only have a few parts left.
Okay, alright, so, fair enough. It would be really dangerous, in all honesty, for Maul to run into the Emperor again. The Emperor kind of proved last time they made contact with each other that he doesn't have any interest in rekindling their relationship, so it might be dangerous for you. So that would be bad.
Yes, definitely.
DJ Elliot.
Yes, right here in the front row.
I'm cool.
I was wondering if you bring in Maz Kanata, since she's 1,000 years old, and we didn't really get to see how much in Force Awakens. so I was wondering if we'd got to, like, learn more about her.
That's a great idea.
Good answer.
You have a good mind for this sort of thing. That doesn't mean anything I've said means we're doing that. Which is sometimes, I'll admit, if I had not thought of it, then it's still a good idea.
I mean, it's an interesting point, babe. As you watched The Force Awakens, were you thinking, oh, I'd like that one?
Oh my goodness. There's so much I would like.
Yeah.
You know, like, they had so many characters in every city, and I have so few. That's, we're a weekly TV show, my friend. But yeah, no, it's great. It's something that's fantastic. Like, now we're a production company making a film every year. There's so much creative talent coming into the studio, whether it be, you know, J.J. Abrams, Michael Arndt, Rian Johnson, Gareth Edwards, you know, and to meet these people and talk with them and to talk Star Wars is just invigorating as a creative. So it's something I'm really grateful for, that Kathy Kennedy has set up in this new era. It's an exciting time to be at Lucasfilm.
Fabulous. I think we've got time for just maybe one or two more questions. So let's get one from Mark first.
I'm with Jake.
Whatever happened to Cad Bane?
Cad Bane, the other blue guy with red eyes. Because for a while on April Fool's, I was going to put up a picture of Cad Bane and be like, ha, you thought it was Thrawn. And it's Cad Bane. But then I thought, no, then all the Bane fans will be mad and there'll be, you know, chaos in the streets. But whatever happened to Cad Bane? Cad Bane's really tough. He's really crafty, really clever. I would wager he might still be around. I don't know what kind of saloon you have to go into to find him, what kind of cantina, but I wouldn't cross him, certainly, or take his name in a bad way. He might be out there, but in Rebels, I don't know. I don't like to keep bringing back all these characters that have talent that I know voicing them. It'd be great to make some new characters and perhaps cast some new people in those roles. I don't know why that striking is a good idea lately, but that might be a good idea.
Good answer. Good answer. Okay, one more question now. We're going to go over to DJ Elliott.
All right, I'm over here, far right.
Oh, there you are.
Hiya, Kevin and Dan. I was just wondering, we saw on your trailer for Series 3 that looked fantastic. There was a ship that looked quite similar to the Outrider.
Yeah.
Are we going to see Dash Green now?
Right? See what I deal with? You see? You see what I mean? Every little thing, Tia, every little thing. They don't even have the ability to frame freeze it yet. They'll later go home and analyze and blow up. They took Fulcrum's voice in Season 1 and augmented it through a thing and tried to figure out who that was.
Did anyone figure it out?
I was prepared for them. But anyway. Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. I would do it. I was a fan. I would augment the voice and change it and figure out who did it. So anyway, see how I'm delaying from answering your question? This is a skill I've learned. Deflecting, talking to Tia. I'll be direct with you, no. But the ship you've got, and it's very similar ship. And something that's exciting is that it's like the same class of ship, if you will. Amy Beth Christian.
YC-2400.
There you go. Amy Beth Christian, who designed it for LucasArts, is now on my staff of Star Wars Rebels. So she got to recreate this ship that she designed long ago for LucasArts, which was an incredibly important moment for her. And I can't stress to you enough how many people on my crew are longtime Star Wars fans, and it's just as deep and meaningful to them to get to bring these things back to life and put them on screen as it is for all of you. So, yes, it is exactly an Outrider class ship. No, I don't want you to be disappointed when the cockpit opens up and Dash Rendar is not there, but, you know.
But Kalkin's one will be in there. Right?
No, why would you?
I'm inciting revolt! Join me!
Woo! Fantastic.
Wow. Played by Warwick Davis.
Woo!
He's clever, see? Oh,
yeah.
Clever.
Gaming allies.
That's it.
And we've had a poll on
nicely. We've learned loads. I got myself a job, and our interest for season 3 is peaked. So please put your hands together and thank Mr. Dave Filoni. Get some popcorn,
all right,
get a good seat, and we'll leave it to you. But thanks very much.
Thanks so much, buddy.
Woo! That's the ending of the panel and the ending of the video today, guys. Thank you so much once again for 200 subscribers. Let's get on the 300th wagon. And that all depends on you. Share your love for Star Wars in the comments below. Let me know what you want to see tomorrow. I'll certainly film it and bring it to you in the third and final day of Star Wars Celebration vlogs. Once more, thank you guys for bringing us to 200 subscribers. The new intro will be here once I get back to Portugal. New movie reviews coming this week. And of course, the special video that I promised you once we hit the 2 subscriber mark. I'll do more than one video to celebrate that. So stay tuned, subscribe, like, and share the video. And of course, join us celebrating the greatest saga ever told. May the Force be with you. Cheers.